I've just got back from my first Spanish coast cruise. I was prepared for things to be different, but there were some real highs and real lows on this cruise that I was not ready for. Even now, I still can't believe some of the things turned out the way they did, but after 2 years in the UK, I was desperate to get away and to get some proper sunshine, so I did try my first international cruise. I was more nervous for this cruise than I have been for anything in a long time. I like to be organised and have everything done ahead of time, but there were constantly changing testing requirements, vaccine requirements, paperwork to fill out, and I was so worried that I would feel totally overwhelmed and just forget something. I did end up making a few silly mistakes on this cruise, which isn't like me, but in my defence, there was a lot to remember, a lot more than on any cruise I've ever been on before. Even filling out one part of one form wrong could mean that I would be stranded in a foreign country, I wouldn't be able to get on my cruise, it would have been a waste of time and money, and it would have been utterly heartbreaking. I did come sickeningly close to missing my flight back from Spain, but more about that later. I didn't know if I would enjoy this cruise in the same way with all of the COVID measures in place. I hadn't been on a plane since 2019, I was nervous about that, and I knew that the ship was sailing well under capacity, and I didn't know if that meant that some of the cruise atmosphere would be lost. I found an incredibly cheap last minute cruise deal though, so I decided to give it a go. It would have been very difficult to book even the cheapest hotel on land for the price that I paid for this cruise, and this cruise included my flights, my transfers, my food, all-inclusive drinks, tips, everything in one price. In total, for the 7-night cruise, I paid £539, which is just over $700, and I knew that I didn't have to spend anything extra if I didn't want to. I'm sure that the cruise line really can't be making any money at this price, because I made it my mission to eat and drink my cruise fare, and I'm sure that I did more than my cruise fare. I booked this cruise as a package through TUI, who own the cruise line Marella, which meant that my flights, my transfers, and my cruise were all together, and that made it so much easier. I did make things a little bit more difficult for myself though. There were four of us going on this cruise, and for some reason it was cheaper to do two bookings of two rather than one booking of four, even for the same people and in the same cabins. It doesn't make sense, but sometimes you have to do slightly strange things to save money, and if you know me, you know that I was willing to make it a bit more complicated in order to save some extra cash. It was worth it. For our specific cruise, we had to do a lateral flow test the day before the cruise and then a PCR test the day after the cruise. They are changing that next week here in the UK so that the afterwards test can be a lateral flow if you're fully vaccinated. If you are taking a cruise anytime soon, make sure you're checking your emails because these changes are happening all the time. Marella were great because they told us what we had to do at different times. It's not that you have to do a lot of things and that the things are complicated, it's knowing what you have to do when that I felt was the tricky part. We booked both the tests through Marella and it only cost £20. If you were to just buy a PCR test on its own, it's normally £70 or £80, so it's a real bargain that Marella did it like that. The kind of bargain cheap thing did become a theme of our cruise, but more about that throughout this video. It was a requirement of our cruise that everybody would be fully vaccinated, and my brother did not make getting the proof of this easy. If you're from the UK, you have to use the National Health Service app and they will verify your identity. My brother decided to wait until the day before the cruise to try and get his vaccine proof. He's been vaccinated for a very long time, but he left that one until last minute. And luckily, and somewhat amazingly, they managed to verify him and give him the proof the same day. Please just get your vaccine proof as soon as you can. Don't leave it until the day before. We needed those vaccine proof letters and those tests when we got to the airport. The test had to be done after 9 p.m. the night before the cruise, and it was such a relief when it came up negative and everybody in my family came up negative. You were not supposed to eat or drink before you do one of those tests. So after I'd done the test and got my negative result, I treated myself to a can of Pepsi Max and a donut, and it felt fantastic to be finally going on the cruise. There were still a few more hoops to jump through to get there, and I was by no means relaxed, but it was a good sign. Perhaps the most time-consuming and tricky part was the Spanish entry form. This is the form that would let us into Spain. If we didn't have this when we got to Spain, they would turn us around and put us on a plane back to the UK. So it was very important that this form was right. We had to complete the form within 48 hours of when we would be arriving in Spain. It wasn't the most difficult form, but it needed an awful lot of reference numbers to do with your vaccines, to do with your tests, right down to which seat you would be sitting in on the plane. There's a lot of information in that form, and realistically, I think it probably took about an hour. When we got to the airport, I was definitely nervous about the flight. I hadn't been on a flight since 2019, and the idea of being in this big flying metal box with so many people did fill me a little bit with dread. I knew that everybody on that plane had had a negative coronavirus test after 9 p.m. the night before. Our flight was around 6 a.m, 7 a.m. in the morning, so I hoped that if everybody was negative at 9 p.m, they would still be at 6 a.m. The only difference was that you had to wear a mask on the plane. Apart from that, everything is business as normal. Full planes, full airports, full everything. When we got into Spain, they looked at our Spanish entry forms and our passports, and thankfully we were allowed to go through. It was so nice to be in a place where people were speaking a different language and I couldn't read all of the signs. I didn't realize how much I'd missed being abroad until I was actually in a different country again. We were happy to get our bags and to get onto the transfer, but we still weren't able to relax at that point. I don't think at the moment, until your feet are on that cruise ship, you can truly relax. We still had one thing to get through, which was the embarkation, and we could still be denied boarding at that point, so I didn't want to count my chickens before they had hatched. Hopefully everyone uses that phrase, don't count your chickens before they've hatched. I also knew that there would be more forms to fill out, more hoops to jump through when we got on the cruise, so I wasn't looking forward to that part. I didn't know at that time how difficult getting home would be, but I'm glad I didn't know at that point. When we got to the cruise port, they checked our boarding passes, our health declarations, our passports, our negative tests, our COVID vaccines, and our travel insurance. A lot of paperwork needed. As soon as we stepped on board the Marella Explorer 2, for me, it was like being back at home. I've cruised with Marella a couple of times and they've always been one of my favorite cruise lines. I hoped that this cruise would live up to my expectations, which were definitely high. My family had never cruised with Marella before, but they'd listened to me talk about it for the last couple of years. So I hoped that it would live up to their expectations. It's horrible when you want to show somebody something and it isn't what you promised. So I really hoped Marella wouldn't let me down. You might recognize the Marella Explorer 2 if you've cruised with Celebrity before around 2015. She used to be the Celebrity Century before Marella took her over. They completely refit the ship, and I don't think you would ever know that this ship was built in the late 1990s. Marella are an all-inclusive cruise line, and like most things that are all-inclusive, they don't truly include everything, but they do include a lot of stuff. So in your cruise day, you've paid for your accommodation, you've paid for the entertainment, you've paid for the food, you've paid for your drinks. Marella include hundreds of drinks, alcoholic, non-alcoholic drinks, and all of the tips and gratuities for the crew. Once you've paid your cruise fare, you don't have to pay anything else on a Marella cruise. It was very strange for me because my last cruise was with Disney and that was very tip focused. Coming across to Marella, where all of the tips are included and you're really not expected to tip above that, I personally much prefer the Marella way, but I know people like both. It even says on your Marella cruise card, remember all tips are included. So they really don't want you to feel like you have to do any extra tipping. We were on board the Marella Explorer 2 for 7 nights and the ship was at well under 50% capacity. I suspect it was around a third full. We were truly spoiled by that. The service was absolutely amazing and we never had to wait for anything. When we got on board, we completed our muster drill on our phones, which was very easy, and then we went, of course, to find an included drink. A favourite spot of mine is this lounge, which is called the Squid and Anchor. It's kind of Marella's take on a pub, and my favourite drink is there. It's called the Electric Lemonade. For me, one of the best things about Marella are not just how many drinks are included, but how easy it is to get a drink. You can order through a waiter, you can go to the bar, but you'll also find these tables that are just set up for you to take a drink. You'll find these around the pool deck, you'll find these when you walk into the theatre, and it just makes it so easy. I'm gonna miss that on every other cruise line. I do think some people worry that if they take an all-inclusive cruise that includes drinks, that people will be drunk, and that's not how it was on this cruise. I think if everybody has all-inclusive drinks for 7 nights, like on our cruise, people don't feel the need to rush and try and drink as much as they can. I have taken a 90s cruise, which was 3 nights with Marella before, and we're doing it again next year. On that cruise, on a 3-night cruise with all-inclusive drinks, you're gonna have people that are drinking as much as they can, but on a 7-night, a 14-night Marella cruise, I didn't see any more drunk people than I would on a normal cruise. If anything, probably less. I think people were pacing themselves. The main dining room has these huge glass windows that I love, and there are huge glass windows like this all over the ship. On a lot of cruise ships, you'll really feel as though you're in a cruise ship, but on this cruise, it was always connected to the ocean. The ship felt very light and bright and airy, and I really don't think you'd know that she was from the 1990s. She feels a lot more modern than a lot of the newer cruise ships that I've been on. After the flight, I was keen to see how Mirella would deal with COVID safety on board. I thought that I would feel a lot safer on the ship than I did on the plane, and I was absolutely right. Everybody on the cruise had been fully vaccinated and tested. We had to wear masks on board, we had to social distance, we had to do daily temperature checks. Even when you came into the theatre, you would be sat down by crew to make sure that there was space between you and the other parties. And when you left the theatre, they would let you go in rows so that there wasn't a big pile up at the door. It was little things like that that had really been thought through by Mirella, and I definitely felt a lot safer on there than I do just at home in England. This cruise was very much designed for me to be a cheap week away in the sun. I wasn't planning on spending much money on board at all, and so I was very happy to hear that we didn't have to do cruise line excursions. We were free to just wander off in each port, just like we used to. Cruise line organised excursions can be expensive. Mirella's are pretty cheap compared to the other cruise lines, but still, if you're going to do them in every port, that definitely can add up. Sometimes it's just nice to go for a walk. We normally walked at least 20,000 steps per day. The temperature was consistently in the mid-20s Celsius or 70s Fahrenheit. For us in the UK, that is gloriously warm, but for everybody in Spain, that was getting a little bit chilly. On a typical day on board, we would get up and have breakfast, then we'd head off and explore the port on our own. We would come back and enjoy all of the included food, of course. We would sit by the pool, there would be live music, we would take part in trivia, relax in our cabin, or go to afternoon tea. We were a fan of afternoon tea. There is so much live music on a Mirella cruise, and the entertainment in the theatre is some of the best that I've ever seen at sea or on land. My first Mirella cruise was 14 nights long, and Mirella put on a different show every single day. The same show team, a different show every single day. Fair enough, there may be some shows where not everybody is in the show, but it was the same core group. How they remembered that many different shows, doing two shows a night, each one about an hour long, I have no idea, but they were always amazing, and I'm very, very impressed. Our cruise started in Malaga and we visited Palamas, Barcelona, Palma, Alicante and Almeria. Almeria was the only place where we did an organised excursion, and there were probably only about 10 of us on that excursion bus. We had to be socially distanced, we had to wear our masks. And I think in Spain they wear their masks a lot more than us here in the UK. Here in the UK masks aren't really compulsory anymore, but in Spain people would wear their masks even when they were skateboarding down the street. Everyone just wore their masks there. Just because we were on the cruise, that didn't mean that all of the forms and the paperwork had ended. We had to do a return to the UK form, a passenger locator form, within 48 hours of coming back to the UK. If you're doing a cruise that leaves from the UK, you can do the form before you go, but because we were flying, we had to fill out that form within 48 hours of getting back to the UK. Mirella very kindly did give everybody a free hour of internet so that they could check their emails and find any reference codes that they needed, and they did have a drop-in place where you could go if you needed help with the forms. Mirella definitely did as much as they could to tell everybody what they needed to do when, and they were available to help if you did need it. We did see people at the airport on the way back who hadn't filled out that form. How they didn't do it, how they missed all of the letters and the announcements, I have no idea. But listen to the cruise line, they're there to help you. I'm not too sure what you would do if you didn't have a phone or a way to show the QR code. I'm sure that Mirella would help you out, but some places are requiring that you have a digital copy and they're not accepting paper copies, which is strange. The whole process is set up assuming that you do have a smartphone or a tablet or some way to show the QR code. If you'd asked me at this point, would I recommend this cruise? It would have been a solid 100% yes for the majority of people. The cruise was absolutely brilliant, and although the paperwork was annoying, it wasn't the end of the world and we managed to do it all fine. Of course, it is more difficult, it's definitely not for everybody, but if you're willing to follow the instructions and do everything that's asked of you, the cruise was totally worth it. That was until we tried to get back to the UK. Our journey back to the UK was stressful, it really was dreadful, and it just left such a bad taste in our mouths after such a good cruise. Our cruise was booked as a part of a package through TUI, which meant that our flights, transfers and cruise were all booked together. That meant that we got up, we got on the transfer buses, we were told which check-in desk to go to, and then the Marella representatives, the TUI representatives, the help, the communication, everything disappeared. We were just left there in Malaga Airport. We joined the TUI check-in queue and noticed that the line was very long. Another lady in the queue said, oh, this will take at least an hour. And I thought to myself, no way is this gonna take an hour. At that point, we had an hour and a half till our boarding gate was supposed to close. We'd already done the online check-in. We had the QR code, we had everything ready to go. So I thought that it would be totally fine. This line was literally just to check a QR code and to drop off our bags. We were in that queue to drop off our bags for 1 hour and 55 minutes. By the time we got to the front, our boarding gate close time had long passed and we had no idea what was happening. If there had just been one person there from TUI, from Malaga Airport, from Marella, who said, you know, we know you're in the queue, we know you're here, the plane's not gonna go without you, it would have been fine, but we had nothing, no communication, no help at all. We didn't know if when we got to that desk, they would say to us, oh, you're too late, you've missed your boarding time. We didn't know if we'd have to run across the airport and then the plane would be gone. We just had no idea. The only kind of reassuring thing was that we were all in the queue together. We'd all come off the same transfers, we'd all stood there for 2 hours, and so we'd all missed our boarding time. It was quite annoying because when we got to that actual desk, it took less than 60 seconds to check that we had the QR codes. I think that the problem was that they only had two desks open for hundreds and hundreds of people who all showed up at once. I feel like they should have known that we were going to show up given that we were on transfers and going on TUI flights. But if they had a separate queue for people who, yes, I've done my QR code, here it is, let me on the plane, and all these other people who maybe hadn't sorted out their forms, we would have been through in 5 minutes rather than 2 hours and avoided all of that stress. When we got past the desk, we ran to security. We hadn't been through security, hadn't been through passport control, hadn't been through anything yet, and we ran across the airport. I did feel bad for the people who were older, who shouldn't have been standing for 2 hours, and they definitely couldn't run across the airport. I honestly don't know what I would have done if I was traveling with children. If I was traveling by myself, I probably would have been crying. There was one older man who ran with us who stopped and he was saying, I need oxygen, I need oxygen. He was totally joking and he was fine, but we were all like that. It was exhausting, it was sweaty. We had no idea if we'd missed our flight. It was very stressful. Your Britishism of the week is the word knackered. The word knackered just means tired, it just means exhausted, and I think it perfectly describes how I felt after running across the airport. I was knackered and sweaty and annoyed, and it was not a good end to the cruise. I had friends who were ahead of me who managed to pick up some water for me, which was an absolute lifesaver. There was no chance that we could stop to get a drink, that we could stop to go to the toilet. We had to run to our gate because we were about almost an hour past the time by that point, and we'd heard nothing. We didn't know that the plane was still there. When we got to the gate, we were in the line again for about half an hour because it turns out that the plane was delayed coming in, but nobody ever told us that. We didn't need to run. If somebody told us at the beginning, we know you're here, the plane's not gonna go without you, it's delayed, you've got time, it would have been fine. Nothing like that though. It's such a shame because the cruise was so brilliant, but the ending was so bad. For me, it was totally worth it. The cruise experience was fantastic, but I'm definitely gonna be avoiding Malaga Airport at all costs in future. Amazingly, I was looking for this video. The price of this cruise has come down since I went on this cruise. You can get it even cheaper than what I did. Crazy. Despite all of the airport drama, this cruise still is one of my favorite cruises. My last cruise that I took on Disney didn't make it into my favorite cruises list. To find out how that cruise went and why a Disney cruise just isn't for me, check out this video next.